also, you're saying about the eyes, what about hearing wise? Because Emily now wears hearing aids, I don't know whether it's the drugs or the disease or, you know.
I think it's that she took.
An interesting question. I'm not aware of any link between the deposits and problems with the ear. The one other place you can see the deposits, which is of no consequence as far as we know, is in the spleen. And that's for anatomical reasons in terms of the structure of the basement membrane where the deposits occur. But I'm not aware of a link with the, and I think you were going to say that maybe some other reason.
Yeah, she was taken, it was one of the medications said early on.
I think it was.
And they said that it was to affect her hearing, possibly.
Right. Yeah.
I think it might have been the rituximab. What you said earlier on, the
rituximab. Yeah, I actually had rituximab.
Okay.
Didn't work, obviously.
when you ask questions like that, I think it's a great question about, you know, what happens to those deposits? Are they going to have any problems with vision? What happens if you go on dialysis? What happens if you've got these treatments, etc.? These are really good questions, and you think the way to answer this is going back to what Stephen was talking about with the database, isn't it? Is connecting information. So that we're not reliant on maybe a serendipity, somebody's, you know, written it up in the scientific literature. We can actually go to a database, and Richard Smith has a database, of course, in the States, and compare and say, well, what is the experience? And then we get much more confident answering these questions.
When that was on dialysis, it was quite relevant, and now nobody ever even mentions it. So, I mean, obviously he is well at the moment, so... But I don't know if you should be having more sort of being kept more of an eye by an optician.
Do you have a protocol? I mean, I do.
My son actually did eye tests since post transplant, and he has it every 6 months.
No, I mean, you haven't had an eye test for a while, but his consultant never mentions it. It's always funny because we sort of think about it, but should that be something that they should think about?
Okay, I would say there'd be no harm in having an eye test once a year.
Mm. Only the importance is overlooked because of the importance of the kidney first.
Yes. Yeah.
Because if you've got a problem in your eyes, then you check.
Yeah.
You know when you showed the slide from your colleague and you said there'd be no point giving the drug at that point? You were saying that on the by looking at those biopsy results.
Yes.
Was really... As a clinician, you would be given the drug at a certain point when creatinine levels were changing, there's more going into the hemophilia.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't be using the pictures of the biopsy to make those decisions anyway, would you?
I would argue, within reason, we don't want to do renal biopsies, you know, in very short intervals. That obviously is not acceptable. But if someone's been stable for a long time and suddenly, you know, the renal function deteriorates, then a biopsy would be a sensible thing to do. And that's very common in other conditions where the kidney's involved. Because I think what we need to get to is a point where we're trying to understand why is that kidney function deteriorated. And the biopsy can provide really, really valuable information.
You do, but you're treating the patient, not the biopsy. You've done the biopsy because it's a problem.
Yes, yes.
You know what I'm saying? No.
You certainly wouldn't biopsy.
So you're saying you wouldn't have interjected and treated them that way when you got to look like that? Well, of course you wouldn't, because you know you wouldn't. That biopsy wasn't necessarily done as a result of a change in the person's creatinine level. That's what you didn't tell them. I mean, on the first slide, was there a raise in creatinine? Was there a deterioration in kidney function?
Yes.
That preempted the biopsy.
Yes. Yeah, so the biopsies, it's uncommon to do what's called a protocol biopsy, where you're going to do a biopsy irrespective of what's happening. Okay, you may see that in a clinical trial. So usually the biopsy is almost always done because of some meaningful change in the clinical condition of the patient or changes in the kidney function. So in those three biopsies, there was a change in each time to justify a biopsy.
Yes, but the first one, the patient in themselves wasn't bad enough to have, a change in the treatment.
But that was the first biopsy that I showed. Yeah, it was very, very inflamed. The patient was unwell. Yeah.
So how were they treated?
They were treated at that stage with steroids, and medication to control their blood pressure,
yeah.
And did relatively well over a period of months.
So you'd always give the, you know, the treatment that was less offensive and fewer side effects anyway, until it deteriorated.
Yes.
More,
yes.
And then you
inject
with a stronger treatment.
Absolutely.
That
yeah.
Would always
yeah. Be. Yeah. But it may be, for instance, you say rather than a stronger treatment, you say that the best treatment almost, right, is what you want, isn't it? You want to say, well, given that.
You want the appropriate treatment.
Exactly. And that's what the biopsy gives you.
Yeah.
Okay. So the biopsy, if you, for instance, saw no C5 in the kidney, okay, then you could potentially argue, and again, this would have to come out of more studies, but if you were then to expose somebody to blockage of C5, a treatment that blocks C5, with no evidence that there's C5 in the kidney, you know, then you're potentially just giving harm, aren't you?
Yeah,
but in that case, though, you wouldn't have known in advance, but in that case, if you had given them Eculizumab at the beginning, it wouldn't have got to that state in the second picture, probably.
Again, that is. There are many cases where Eculizumab is not mediating a response, and maybe people...
But it did clear out the kidney, so the probability that in that patient they wouldn't have deposited C5. They couldn't have deposited C5 if they're on Eculizumab, could they?
That's correct, but that at the beginning, that first biopsy, Eculizumab wasn't selected because there was no evidence that...
No, I understand. You need hindsight to make that decision.
Yeah.
But if we had the... diagnostic knowledge to make that decision early, then that would have stopped that patient going through that.
Absolutely. And the diagnostic knowledge would be the renal biopsy. Okay.
I think it's important to point out that C5 is not a routine stain, as many of you have found out, so we always stain C3 and C1Q and other different complex proteins. C5 is not relevant for very, very many kidney diseases, and it's not done
routinely done in
a clinical laboratory. So if anybody's been applying to try and have Eculizumab, one of the extra tests that has to be done is a C5 stain. It would be nice going forward that we can try and encourage that is asked for with all kidney biopsies, but it's such a rare condition, and having that knowledge through every nephrologist that might see one case that you must ask for C5,
Another point to make as well is that in order to know that C5 is causing the damage within the kidney, is there another way we can find that information out without doing a biopsy? Okay, and that would be called a biomarker. So it's it's marking something, if you like. And there's a lot of interest in looking at C5 in the blood sample, C5 activation in the blood sample. And that's something that has come out in some of the studies as looking promising. There are patients in whom it doesn't correlate. It's not absolute, but there's a lot of interest in that. And we would call that serum biomarker. So we can then say to somebody, well, look, we don't need to go back in and do an invasive procedure. It looks like, at this point, as well as C3 activation, C5 is activating, and a strategy that takes away that C5 component. And we're just talking about Eculizumab, a lot of other things are going to come online, would be the best approach.
Absolutely.
Yeah, they're not exclusive. Yeah. We can do them both.
It's an argument for that being repeated at intervals, because we have myself as well, the serum and the compound.
Yes.
And then what you really want to do is you want to do that annually, except for something over regular periods of time.
Yeah.
Because surely it's the change that's relevant.
Absolutely.
Because it can be fluctuating.
Oh, we know in all of us it can fluctuate. So it's an inexpensive test, and it's something that I would argue that we should do in everybody quite regularly. You have a blood test for lots of reasons, aren't you?
Yeah.
So it's not, yes.
It's relatively inexpensive then.
Yes.
To spot that trend. Why is that not being done?
Because we're still in the stage where we're not sure what to make of that information. That's the difficulty. Okay? And that goes back to when we're not in a situation where we know for sure what the best response to do for the patient is with that biomarker. Okay?
If it's a relatively cheap procedure, why are you starting to do that? So when you've got that
of knowledge, you can look back at that sequence.
Well, that is something that the focus group, if you like, is trying to explore, is to say, yes, well, why don't we offer that test more widely? So, for instance, we've started to offer the test for the staining of C5 in the kidney within the Hammersmith, and we get requests from, you know, the local hospitals, Evelina, for example, send us samples to look at. But at the moment, it's not available sort of widely. It doesn't have to be in some ways. As long as people know where to access it, they can send the samples to a specialist centre.
I would have thought that it was more accurately to subdivide people using actual figures from blood tests rather than a visual interpretation of biopsy.
The biopsy is probably, but it's pretty much the gold standard, isn't it, sort of what goes on, and the blood samples are less accurate.
Oh, are they? Well, even these measures?
Yes.
Because
what you're dealing then is a biomarker. It's a marker of what you really would like to look at. So let's say, for instance, there's no hindrance to doing a biopsy at all. You get the information there.
Yeah.
There obviously is, so you're linking a test, a biomarker. So it's a question how accurate this is to what you really want to know.
If it's not regularly being done, then you won't know.
In those children who are in the samples that were done regularly every 6 months, we've measured the C5 beta-9 levels. So that's a separate bit of data that we'll be looking at to see whether that correlates with any changes in clinical condition. I think what we're saying is that is still a sample that's at the research stage because we don't know what it means. We think that it should correlate with a bad episode, and
we're actually still a
step back. So the fact that it's not widely clinically available is because we don't know what it means. So you can get into trouble if you start doing tests thinking you know what they mean, but you don't know what they mean because you start interpreting them wrongly. So there will be, in those people who've had regular samples, we will be able to go back and say, okay, did this correlate with flares of disease and things like that?
We have done that in the
children in that cohort for the ones that we took regular samples on.
Where it is a good test is on patients on eculizumab. So because you really should not see it at all, of course, because you switched it off.
Yeah. Mm.
So it's been used a lot in that situation. So if you get somebody on eculizumab with atypical HUS who's starting to get ill again, one of the things you could say is maybe they're no longer responding to eculizumab, but of course the immediate worry is you're not giving them enough. And it's used in that setting quite commonly. And you can see that it starts to go up in certain situations, particularly when people get infections. Right, your complement system sort of, if you like, turns on a bit more. So maybe you need a bit more eculizumab at that stage. Right. Now, obviously, you can't go and biopsy in the kidney, but you can see that the C5B9 starts to go up. So you increase the dose down, it goes in. But that's where we understand it's you know, we're using it for a specific question. Have we switched off C5?
Right, so it's useful for that.
For that, yeah.
I have a question about those slides again. Could you flick back to that slide?
Mm.
Yeah. So it looks like the C3's gone down as well.
Yeah.
And that was after applying eculizumab.
Yeah.
If I understood right, then eculizumab shouldn't shut down C3.
So here you have looking similar to here, but certainly obviously much better than this, isn't it? Mm. And C3 can be produced when you have inflammation. You have lots of inflammatory cells in the kidney. They produce C3 and they contribute to that C3 that you see in the biopsy. So generally, when you reduce inflammation, you'll get the C3 level going down as well. Now, there's various again in the literature, and it may be because it's related to inflammation rather than anything that eculizumab is surprisingly doing to C3, which wouldn't make a lot of sense to us. There are reasons we could conceive of how it would reduce C3, but it would be a surprise. And again, generally, a big drop in C3 is not seen with eculizumab. There are exceptions, but generally no. Of course, many people have not got the biopsy staining. You know, not every sort of biopsy after eculizumab. But the point I'm trying to make here is that there's obviously different situations where you might select different treatments. And that's very, very common in other kidney diseases. So the biopsy is done not just to diagnosis, but to say, what's actually going on in that kidney. Okay, so if you take a condition, look after a lot of patients with lupus, we say lupus affects the kidney in many, many different ways. So we don't just do it for a diagnosis. We say, well, what's actually happening in that patient at that time? Do I need to switch off inflammation? Do I need to switch off protein leak? Both. Or it doesn't look as bad as I thought. I don't need to expose a patient to any potentially harmful therapy. This is not a dangerous lesion.
So you said that there's requests, and you've got a lot of emails from people about compliments. Do you have any of their names? Like companies and stuff.
Companies. I do have their names. Yeah. You just think of a big pharma company, and I think it'd be hard to think of one that has not got a compliment research program.
Can I ask you about compspetting?
So compstatin, again, I think that is that I'm not aware of progress towards trials in this specific condition, but that is a very potent C3 inhibitor, and it's been around. I mean, Kevin will back me up here for how long? And there's always been the promise of compstatin that it's going to get into the clinical arena sometime soon, and we're still at the stage where we're being told that. So I've not been contacted to say, you know, what about considering using this in this condition?
It's still rapidly clear at that one, isn't it?
One of the difficulties with C3 is one of the and this is like a sort of a drug development issue. It's an extremely abundant protein. So compared to C5, so if you were to produce an antibody to try and switch off C3, you'd have to infuse huge amounts into people. Okay, and most drug development people say that's just not, that is not an approach you even begin to start. Compstatin binds to C3, and again, the issue has always been about it will be cleared rapidly and it just won't be effective.
So hasn't compstatin analog overcome that problem?
Oh, it binds increasingly strongly to C3, and that's the sort of we're smiling because over the years it's been refined to bind even tighter to C3. But at some point, we're saying to the people involved in this, and I know them very well, is, are you going to take the next step, or next year you're going to modify it again to become a little bit stronger? If you go up to how C3 is activated, then you're dealing with components that are very, very, the word is druggable, okay, because they're very small, relatively small concentrations, they're rate limiting, and there's a lot of interest and compounds out there. Some of them will be in the public domain that target that. Genentech, which is a big company, have an anti-factor D antibody, which you need to activate C3. As an example. They've not chosen to inhibit C3 directly.
So is the idea to use radar as a way that once they actually start with the trials, as a way to get people to do the trials on? Is that what the sort of one of the goals is of radar?
Yeah, I would say as Stephen's I would say that is to When you're designing a clinical trial, obviously you're selecting, patients in whom you think are most likely to benefit from that approach, and I think the data that would come from radar and experience with other treatments would be exactly where you could potentially get that information. It won't be exclusive to radar. That's not to say you're not in radar. But don't get me wrong. That companies, and it's likely that this will be global as well. Most companies who I discuss with don't look for single sites because of the rarity of the condition. They'd be looking at global studies.
Emily, do you have a question?
Yeah, no, I was just going to ask. So without doing a biopsy, would you know that you had MPGN again? So, like, obviously, when you first get it, you know that you've got it because you're really unwell, but would you then become unwell again?
You, The answer is you wouldn't know for certain because that's how you diagnose it.
Yeah.
So without doing a biopsy, you wouldn't be able to confidently say there is no MPGN. If you're completely well and your urine test is fine and everything's stable, then you know we'd be pretty confident that if it's there, it's not causing trouble.
Right.
And it might not be there. But that wouldn't be an indication, I think Sally would agree, to say to you, well, we better do a biopsy, shall we, just to look. No, we wouldn't do that.
Okay.
Anyone else? Mm-hmm. I'd just like to thank Matthew for... we've caught up by... Well, we're behind another 5 minutes again, so I think we'll just have a 10-15 minute coffee break and then we'll get stuck back into it again, yeah?